the opportunities, roughly for around 30 to 40 minutes. And then last, I'll take questions and answers. Okay, so let's start speaking with about Excelta. We are an IoT startup, as you probably know. We are in the business of IoT education as well as IoT product development. We have been rated as one of the top IoT startups in India by a couple of magazines, CIO Review and Silicon India. And we have maximum number of IoT trainings that are available anywhere in the world. We have IoT boot camps. We have a new training that we launched recently in IoT analytics. We are launching a new training very soon on MQTT, as well as we are launching a new program on IoT for kids, which we are going to launch in a franchise way. We are talking about the solutions that we have built are machine and deep learning enabled solutions, where you can do analytics based decision supports. We have developed solutions in the retail industry, security industry, home automation industry. We already have Fortune 500 clients, like clients like Coca-Cola India, Intel. We can count among them our clients. We have an end-to-end service offering. We are seeing a lot of traction in the market. That's very positive for us. We are seeing a lot of people, interested people in IoT, entrepreneurs, startups, as well as established industry trying to reach out to us to figure out ways of how we can collaborate and stuff. So we are seeing a lot of traction in the market in terms of IoT. That's where, the thoughts that, people were having that, will there be opportunities in IoT? Or will IoT lead to a lot of business, as the hype was there, but actually on the ground, people are not able to see earlier the things. Now we can vouch for it. We are actually seeing things happening on the ground. And daily we are, seeing inquiries and things happening. So by being in the thick of things, we can kind of vouch for it. So we have created an excellent IoT ecosystem where we are kind of connected to thousands of people worldwide and the professionals who have done our trainings, as well as people who are working in IoT or who want to work in IoT. And we basically, own that ecosystem, and we are seeing that thing happening on the ground where IoT is picking up really fast. So this is our profiles. Me and my partner Manish Agarwal, we started this company two and a half years back. As I said already, we both go back a long way. We have known each other for more than 21 years, and we have worked in different companies quite a bit all over the world. So that's what we are. I'll just move ahead. So as you know, this is a prediction by Gartner that by 2020 you will have, or 2070 or 2020, let's say, you will have a requirement 400,000 IoT developers by 2017, and some people are saying you will require probably 1 million developers by 2020. So the market is exploding, and we are already seeing things happening on the ground, as I mentioned. So IoT is today where analytics or big data was in 2010-11, very nascent stage, or cloud was in 2004, or Java was in 1998. So those who jumped into that bandwagon at that point of time really had, the time to learn things, to develop their approach, and really make hay when the sun started shining. Okay, so IoT is at that point today, the point of flexion. So those who join the IoT bandwagon right now can really make hay in the coming years, as this is going to become one of the largest, provider of job opportunities or opportunities for entrepreneurs in future. And just to remind you guys that please keep typing your questions, whatever questions that come to your mind related to the topic or unrelated also. I'll be taking up questions at the end for like almost 15 minutes, whatever number of questions are there. So please keep typing your questions. I will not be answering them right now. I'll be taking them at the end. So it just takes a little bit of guts to jump into this domain. Okay, and also this domain is not about learning something very new. As you will see as I go along, that this domain is something where you can reuse the knowledge that you have and then position yourself as IoT resources. And the way IoT business is progressing, what we are seeing on the ground, it's a highly disruptive technology, much more disruptive than cloud and big data and other technologies. And it of course makes use of those technologies to become even more disruptive. Okay, and it is just about exploding now. It's just expanding. So if you jump into this domain now, you can really make fortune in future. Now let me do one thing. Let me quickly explain what IoT is about in next 5 minutes, and then we will go into details of it. So you see these devices, right? Anything above $100 value. We want to make them into IoT devices, smart devices in other words. So in IoT, when any device wants to or has to become smart, it has to be given an identity. Okay, so you will give a unique ID to this, maybe an IPv6 kind of address. Okay, and then once it has a unique identity, you start calling it a node, or you start in making it, make each of these things, you know, into a node where you will be putting a lot of sensors inside it. Also give it an ability to talk to the outside world using protocols like Bluetooth, Bluetooth Low Energy, ZigBee, Z-Wave, right? So this node is nothing but this device. Okay, it's a small electronic kind of component, you can say, which is fitted onto these things to make them smart. Either retrospectively or while manufacturing itself, you have built a lot of sensors inside it, and you have built a communication mechanism inside it. And this communication mechanism allows the sensor data to be passed to the outside world and also receive instructions and take some action. Okay, the arrow goes both ways. And it talks to the outside world, typically using protocols like Bluetooth, ZigBee, Z-Wave, Bluetooth Low Energy, to a device like called a gateway. Gateway could be your smartphone, to which can talk using Bluetooth or Bluetooth Low Energy, or a gateway which can be built to talk using ZigBee, Z-Wave, Bluetooth, Bluetooth Low Energy, any of those protocols, right? Several such protocols are there. And both these devices, which are called gateways, can then communicate to the cloud-based system using channels like 2G, 3G, 4G, and protocols like HTTP over REST, or REST over HTTP, sorry, or MQTT, or AMQP, or several such protocols are there, which can be used to communicate from a gateway to a cloud-based system. This cloud-based system is, in other words, is also called ERP of things. It's like SAP of IoT. You know, that's what we are calling it. It has an ability to communicate to the devices, right? All these devices can talk using this channel, this method to it. Also, it has a big data analytics capability built into it so that it can analyze data coming in from those billions and trillions of connected devices, right? And take some action also if required. So then action point can also be pumped back into the node or the thing, or through a cell phone into the, right? A cell phone can also directly operate. So this is what an IoT ecosystem is about, an end-to-end ecosystem where things become smart to collect data about their property, which can be sensed, and then pass the data to a cloud-based system using gateways, and then receive back instructions, if any, to take care of the situation, and all without human intervention. And you see this line here that I've drawn. Everything above this line is like a little bit domain specific, where your analytics piece is highly domain specific. What kind of reports you will do, what kind of analysis you will do, all will be done here. Using very, very domain specific knowledge is required. What kind of sensors will go into, let's say, a washing machine or a refrigerator or an air conditioner or a machine in a factory? You and I cannot decide that. It's also, again, domain specific. So a lot of domain specific knowledge required here above this line. And everything below this line is highly generic. You know, this chip used to pass data using any of these protocols is very generic. Then you have a gateway. The smartphone could be any company's smartphone. Your gateway could be any company's gateway, right? Your cloud-based system, there are a plethora of cloud-based systems. I've seen, what I've shown here is like Axelta's platform, which is Osmosis. But there are lots of such platforms which are there in the market today, literally hundreds, including ThingWorx, Zively, Predix from GE, if you know, IBM Bluemix, Microsoft Azure, you know, Amazon IoT platform. So all these are platforms which are there, literally available in dozens. Okay, and all of them have these big data analytics capabilities. But what kind of analytics to do has to be done by domain-specific people. So that opens a huge number of opportunities. And then building this node in the right way also requires a lot of domain-specific knowledge. So moving on, you know, as I said, everywhere domain-specific, domain-specific. So, you know, there are a huge number of use cases in IoT. So IoT technologies, you have several IoT technologies. I'm going to talk about them. And then use cases, you know, of IoT. Essentially going towards infinity means there are n number of possibilities. Each and every aspect of human activity, you know, will get impacted in some way or the other. And every use case, you know, also requires a unique handling, because you require unique sensors or sensors used in a unique way to handle a use case. You also require analytics and other things to be done in a unique way. So the number of opportunities essentially are infinite. That's where, because it's so domain specific, you are finding that not too many IoT products in the market right now, because it's difficult to build. It's not so easy to build an IoT product which works end to end, works reliably. That's where you know, a lot of products are coming in. Some of them are failing also, but some of them are really picking up. But the real, even an Apple Watch, I'll call it an IoT device, not that successful. I mean, not that useful also, in other words. But a lot of work getting into it now, which will really make it useful. And that's where a lot of opportunities start coming out. So as I mentioned earlier, IoT is not a technology. It is a amalgamation of a lot of existing technologies to solve a business problem. Okay, it's a new approach to solving a business problem, let's put it like this, and which where you can use all your existing knowledge from whatever field you are in. You are required in IoT also. You just need to develop some skills. That's where we in Excelta, we have our trainings that we do, you know, IoT trainings, and people who are from all walks of life are attending them to get that initial step into IoT space, to be able to figure out what role they will play or they can play in an IoT world. And IoT is about no human intervention, as I said, and IoT is domain specific. So these are some of the areas which are opening up in IoT. And by any means, this is not a complete list. This is something that we have thought about, and there are lots and lots of possibilities which are maybe over and above this. But I've tried to put together some of these possibilities, and I'm going to go into some of them in some detail so that maybe you can see where you stand. So I'll take one hardware and one software kind of example, and then analytics of things, and how these things together can really make a change in your career aspiration and path also. So node experts, you know, lots and lots of people. So we are talking, when we're talking about node experts, we're talking about connecting billions of devices. So we want to make, you know, anything and everything of $60 value or $100 value for that matter into a smart thing, right? So that means we need to fit a node into it to be able to make it communicate to the outside world, to be able to receive instructions from the outside world, right? So that opens up huge opportunities. A node is also called a highly constrained device. So now just imagine the case of Samsung AC, and Samsung sells millions of air conditioners worldwide. Now, if the node, if making it into a smart node, adds $10 to a Samsung AC, Samsung sold 10 million air conditioners, it will add $100 million to the cost of Samsung manufacturing ACs, right? So that is not acceptable, right? So the cost of node has to be very, very less. And because the cost has to be very less in cents, in you know, millicents or cents maybe, that's where it adds lots of other constraints to it. Too much power to be consumed, especially when you talk about wearable devices or devices which are out in the open, you know, which should not come, which are run on battery or solar power, consumption becomes a huge. Size becomes very important in things which are in size, like your wearable devices, for example, or anything that you have on your body, or things which can go into bigger things to make, to read value. All of them needs to be physically constrained. Because the cost is such a constraint, you can't put too much computational ability onto a node. So it becomes constrained in computational ability. You can't put too much algorithm on it, right? Also, you need to have a node to communicate to the outside world. On one side, it communicates to the sensors, to be able to read sensor data. Okay, and on the other side, it needs to communicate to the cloud-based, you know, or the gateways basically, using low energy, low range protocols, BLE, ZigBee, Z-Wave, Bluetooth. You know, BLE is kind of becoming a de facto standard there. So you have to have that ability in a node. Then you have to have a remote sensing ability. I said it should be able to sense data from multiple sensors, should be able to multitask and don't miss data and all that, should be able to securely communicate. You don't want hackers to come in, right? It should be sturdy, because many of the things are mechanical things which move, a lot of vibrations and stuff. It has to be very sturdy. Also, another key thing is, like when Samsung has installed, let's say, this smart, made smart ACs installed all over the world, it wants to upgrade them or add a new sensor or add a new data item which wants to pull from these ACs. It can't, you know, again, go revisit each AC and upgrade that physically. So it has to be over the air updatable, where you are able to push in new codes, get new information out from the system as the technology progresses and stuff like that. So it has to be over the air. All these things lead to a huge number of, you know, a huge number of job opportunities, okay, for professionals like you and me. So for example, you're talking about a node. A node is nothing but a piece of firmware, a hardware, right, which is a microcontroller, sensors, okay, and then lot of another piece of code for to be able to communicate with the outside world. So, and also, as I said, it has to be power constrained. So a lot of optimized way of programming. So not for firmware programming experts, they have to learn about lazy programming where nodes sleeps most of the time, only wakes up when it needs to send data. You know, it has to be multi-threaded programming, interrupt-based programming, when as an interrupt happens or some event happens, then only you wake up. And then you do something and again go back to sleep so that you consume as little power as possible. There are several, you know, real-time operating systems which have come out, which are very, very microscopic kind of operating systems. Some of these, like Kucox, for example, are like 32 KB RAM, 32 KB kind of, you know, operating systems, which only consume 32 KB of RAM. And they can do multitasking and other things for you. So people who are knowing firmware programming, if they can develop skills on RTOS programming, like Kucox, Tiny Operating System, Free RTOS, Tizen from Samsung, so then a lot of requirement for those guys in the industry. You know, people who can understand the interfaces and write device drivers for sensors, multiple kinds of sensors using I2C, SPI, USB kind of interfaces, a lot of opportunities opening up for them. There are a lot of system on chips now available in the market, like there is a Nordic NRF51822, which uses Bluetooth low energy to communicate to the outside world. There is a Texas Instruments CC2540 chip with a lot of sensors built into it. It also has a built-in Bluetooth low energy kind of module on it. So these SoCs, people who have skills in these SoCs and who can do programming, can help prototyping quickly. Big demand for such people opening up worldwide. Then you have a lot of prototyping platforms. See what has happened in Java earlier, where you had free Java, you know, libraries, everything available, people can go and code. It was never true for hardware. For hardware, you needed to make it. Now, a plethora of platforms have come out, like, you know, Arduinos, Raspberry Pi, Red Bear. So all these platforms are available free of cost, or not free of cost, but almost free of cost. For example, an Arduino board today is available for less than like $10 or $12, you know, Arduino Uno, where it has a microcontroller on it, which you can really use to do a lot of programming on it. You can connect, you know, several sensors to it, read data in a reliable way, send it to a cloud-based system, do a lot of things around it. So these platforms have been built in such a way to allow you to do prototyping of your, you know, products or whatever you have ideas fairly quickly. For example, in the training that we do in IoT, in Excelta, you actually use Arduino and several sensors, and you do a lot of things. You send data using Wi-Fi, you send data using GSM, you actuate actions back on it. You do a lot of things in that training. So that kind of platforms has really provided an ability for us or anybody to get in with a little bit of knowledge about, you know, embedded programming, not more than a couple of months knowledge. You can really build working systems and, you know, and actually make test things and make prototypes. And if the idea clicks, it's easy to go to the next level. I will not say easy, but at least possible, which was not possible like 5, 7 years, 10 years back. Okay, a lot of, you know, client-side developments of, you know, for example, many of these cloud-based systems will require a lot of client-side development where you need to communicate to these platforms on the cloud. Their SDKs you have to implement in your microcontroller or microprocessor that you are using. So all these, you know, client-side developments require skills. So if somebody has done that, automatic demand in the market for it. So huge opportunity opening up for embedded programmers, for protocol developers. As I said, Bluetooth, Bluetooth Energy, ZigBee, Z-Wave, you know, IP, knowledge on IPv6, all these kind of protocols, you know, require, a lot of these protocols have been there for quite some time. But then using them for IoT in a cost and a power effective way is the key. So if you are an expert in any of these protocols, you can reposition yourself on IoT side and use the features of these protocols to develop programs for this. You know, there are a lot of consortiums which have come out. Okay, like, you know, if you know Industrial Internet Consortium, then there's All Scene Alliance, Apple MFI certification, Google Thread. You know, all these are consortiums which have come out, which are giving out guidelines of how to build an IoT device which is scalable and power conscious, constrained, and all that. So understanding these guidelines from these consortiums is another opportunity opening up. Okay, I'm putting it in protocols because protocols are also built into these guidelines. Okay, so any sort of deep knowledge in any of these protocols, big plus today. And ability to quickly develop and test prototypes using these kind of protocols, a big opportunity opening up. And if you can, if you have some idea, you want to build a prototype, you can today buy this hardware and stuff and build that small prototype in a couple of days or few days. And you know, then maybe some investor who's, you can approach an investor, you can approach your organization, show them those devices, and opportunities can open up for you. Automation experts. So lots of automation people are there in the industry, right? Who have already automated a lot of industry. Now, those automation experts who know how to use sensors, you know, who knows how to use, for example, different vast variety of MEMS sensors like gyroscopes, accelerometers, are there. So how to read data from these sensors in a reliable way? What are the reliable sensors in the market? How to connect these sensors? You know, where all we should place these sensors in a device to get accurate values out? How these sensors behave over a period of time, and how the errors get created in them? How we can programmatically handle these errors? All these are huge opportunities which are required in IoT. Earlier you were automating a plant. Now you are talking about automating the world, basically. Homes, billions and millions of devices that we use. So the market expanding exponentially for you. And therefore, and for example, companies like Axalta, today we are smaller companies. Tomorrow we want to work on a use case. And you are a sensor expert. We need guys like you. But we can't afford to hire you full time. So, you know, if somebody like that who is good and experienced in automation and sensor knowledge, good time for him to open a consulting kind of business. Because there are people like us and hundreds of startups worldwide who are waiting to kind of hear from you and, to use your services for our products, which we can't afford full time, but at least partially we can pay and make it happen. So big opportunities for product experts. So there are domains opening up in a way, right? So for example, there were SAP experts earlier, or Microsoft .NET experts and all that. They're going to be experts in IoT areas, like beacon experts or retail experts in beacons, vehicle tracking experts, right? So wearables. Wearables is going to redefine the way mobile phones work or a lot of products around us work, because wearables are going to take care of that. So wearable experts. And who is a wearable expert today? How many people in the world will be wearable expert? Very few, right? You can count on your fingers probably. So if somebody is expert in building some products or something, he can recondition himself for wearing, for you know, wearable kind of products, miniaturizing things, making the material friendly to skin and sturdy and all that. Huge opportunities opening up. If you have been working in any of the domains that I mentioned here, okay, you just, you know, I can guarantee you, do our training in Axalta or somewhere else, and then you can reposition yourself as an IoT expert in these domains, if you are from any of these domains. Okay, because huge opportunity opening up in each domain, you require thousands upon thousands of experts, okay, who understand the business side of things. So mechanical and material professionals, building those small devices, things which are sturdy, lightweight, quality, which material doesn't react to skin, best colors, environmental impact is less, you know, pollution, corrosion impacts are less. People who have mechanical kind of knowledge can really position themselves as node experts and can, you know, open their consulting services or stuff like that, or join organizations, which can really, you know, kind of escalate, put your career on a fast track. Productionizing concern, again, like for example, in Axalta, we have built some devices. When we want to productionize it, you know, we are talking about building 10,000 of those devices, 100,000 of those devices. That's an entirely different ballgame. You have to negotiate with vendors, negotiate with manufacturers, get it done from somebody. So there are product consultants who know about this. So they can really be helpful and they can, you know, really help us do that. So people who are in that space, really required by startups and companies who are getting into IoT space, basically. Again, for the software guys now, you know, IoT is opening up huge, huge area. And in fact, this is going to be much bigger than what we can imagine. In fact, hardware is going to be like 35% or 30% of IoT. The software, if I include big data analytics into the software, you know, it is going to be like 60% of the opportunity lies in this side. That's a huge opportunity for software guys is opening up. So one is the, you know, there are a lot of cloud-based systems, as I mentioned earlier. The ThingWorx, the Osmosis platform, you know, IBM BlueMix, Microsoft Azure. So consultants are required for that. Like you have SAP consultants, you will have Microsoft Azure consultants. You already have Microsoft Azure consultants, Amazon IoT consultants who can take a device and connect it to a platform and, you know, process the data of that platform and then define the rules and stuff inside that platform. build integration of the platform. So I'll come into all those things, but big opportunity opening up for middleware platform experts who can take your devices to the cloud, basically. So for developers like who are Java developers, let's say, or .NET developers, or Python experts, or Node.js, or you know all those experts, all these platforms are essentially built in either Java or .NET. So developers are required to work in these platforms. Like if somebody wants to take his devices data to a platform, like you can see here the diagram of Excelta's platform. Now you want to connect your devices to the platform. So connection is easy, you know, but then there will be things like, you know, you have to develop a lot of analytics on top of it. You'll have to integrate it with other platforms or your inside systems. All those require a lot of, you know, technical skills. You have this experts which are required to learn new protocols like MQTT and CoAP, which are protocols which work on the server side of things or cloud side of things to be able to help devices communicate to the cloud. For example, we in Excelta are very soon launching a training on MQTT. So that is required. When data is coming from millions of devices to the platform, you require data streaming experts. So I'll talk about those a little bit later, but lots and lots of opportunities opening up. There are products which are opening up, like for example, Google has its own Google Fitness API, Apple Fitness API, Android Wearable, you know, big library is there. Fitbit of the world, even Samsung has come up with its own, you know, fitness APIs. So people who have any knowledge on any of these APIs, which are typically in Java or .NET, you know, can really propel your career, and you can be part of these organizations building many of these wearables and other devices or big databases. Integration experts. Many of these platforms require integration with backend systems. Like, for example, there's a SAP which is already running in your company, and then you launch devices for IoT. Then these IoT devices communicate to IoT platform on the cloud. Let's say Microsoft Azure platform. And then this platform will get all the data, but the data needs to come back into SAP systems or PeopleSoft systems or Oracle systems, right? And then some sort of workflow needs to happen, some decisions need to be made, some reporting needs to be generated. All that requires a lot of integration experts, you know, enterprise application integration experts who can handle that. And now the data is going to be huge because we're talking about billions of devices. Millions of devices. So, real experts who can understand how to handle that huge amount of data and integrate in a seamless manner. So, those experts are going to be huge demand, are already being in demand. We are already seeing demand for that, especially for Microsoft Azure, IBM Bluemix consultants. Already there is a lot of demand. And even GE predicts a lot of demand is happening in the market. Data security, of course, data has to securely transfer from one place to another, right? So, encryption, decryption, identity management of millions of devices, security of the cloud-based system. Security is always going to be a concern. And if you are a security expert in any sense, you can reposition yourself as an IoT expert by understanding the IoT business. Okay, you just need to do that, and then you can reposition yourself. And for that, as I mentioned earlier, you can attend some trainings and stuff like that. For cloud experts, you know, people who are already working on clouds, now it's about not only about humans attaching to cloud, right? It's about these billions of devices. So how to handle data from coming from billions of devices? Data centers specialists, you know, data centers need to probably today, if there are, just imagine there are, let's say, 1,000 data centers in this world, we will need a million data centers in future. So you can imagine the kind of growth that is going to happen over the next 10, 20 years, and how many more data center specialists are required, security experts are required. So huge opportunities opening up for cloud experts who understand how to deploy application on any of these clouds like AWS, Azure, and how to do it securely, multi-tenant way, architect the applications in that way, you know, how to set up load balancers and stuff, how to take backups, every you name it, how to automate processes, lots and lots of opportunities opening up. What is complex event processing? Complex event processing is about your, you know, millions of devices sending data to cloud. Now, let's say I'm a cloud-based system, and there are million devices connected to me, and I'm expecting 10,000 devices simultaneously sending me data. Now, I have to go through those 10,000 data items coming in very, very quickly in a fraction of a second, and I have to figure out that one data which is coming from one machine, which is having an error, and I need to take action, maybe inform somebody, maybe reply back to that machine. Imagine that, you know, millions of cars are connected to my platform, okay, and in one particular car, an intruder is getting inside. Or brake oil is about to finish. Okay, so I need to immediately inform either the driver of the car, or I have to immediately shut down the engine of the car. Okay, depends on what kind of logic I build on my cloud-based system. So as soon as data comes in, I figure out, okay, an intruder is directly in this car. This person is not among the authorized users of the car. So I immediately send a signal to the car saying this car engine will freeze in the next 30 seconds. Please park it. So the guy has to park it. You know, otherwise the engine freezes basically, and also inform the police about it and stuff like that. So these are this kind of handling of millions of data items coming in simultaneously, and to be able to process it and figure out that one record which is causing an issue or I need to take an action is what complex event processing is about. And a lot of software technologies, like you have IBM streaming, Microsoft streaming softwares, you have Kafka from your Hadoop ecosystem and stuff like that, which are essentially in this space. So developing skills in any of these complex events processing space, which is going to be an extremely high paying, you know, job in the IoT world, is a very, very good skill area to have today. And there are lots of, you know, it's a highly complex area. I'm not saying it's an easy area to master, but if you Java or something, or Microsoft.NET, and getting into this, and if you're able to understand and visualize, you are almost at par with data scientist. Okay. So lots of IoT jobs coming up in the market. We are seeing them, and we are seeing lots of trainings happening in industry internally right now, and also positions now we are starting seeing the trickling of positions outside where people are looking for IoT experts, you know, end-to-end IoT knowledge experts, or automation experts, sensor experts, software developer experts, CP experts, cloud-based system experts who have handled IoT in some way. So that kind of knowledge today, if you get, real game changer, and that's where Excelta can help you develop that knowledge. If you attend any of our trainings like IoT analytics training or IoT boot camps that we currently do, and that can really help propel your career. Big data analytics is a huge area opening up. In fact, 35% of IoT is about big data analytics. Okay, and you know, big data analytics expert typically get paid 20 to 100% more than your Java experts, even Java architects. Okay, so that's the kind of opportunity that is there. So when you get data from these billions of devices, or even hundreds of thousands of devices, let's say, and to analyze that data based on domain experts' knowledge, so you have to talk to the domain expert and then develop that knowledge to be able to use programming languages like R and others to figure out that value in that data, to be able to either proactively take action. For example, let me give you an industrial IoT example that we came across recently, where like you have a factory which has hundreds of motors and pumps being used in that factory. And if any pump or motor were to go bad, you know, it leads to the stopping of that production line, which leads to huge losses for the company. So if you can build that system which can, you know, your data is coming from all these pumps and motors, and you can proactively figure out this pump is about to go bad because it is now emitting more sound, or it is vibrating a lot, or it is consuming more than required, or the body of the pump is heating up. I'm just giving some examples. Okay, then you can take proactive action saying this pump is about to conk off. Please either maintain it, do a planned maintenance, or change it. Okay, and then a person can take those actions before the pump actually goes bad. So that is what we are talking about when we talk about big data analytics. Huge area opening up. And we also have launched a training called IoT and analytics. Very interesting session where we teach you R programming language, as well as how to use R in an actual use case from an insurance industry. So that kind of thing can really propel you, you know, to really develop your career in analytics, because that's the area which I can guarantee you is going to be there for the next 50 to 20 years and really, really explode. Okay, and people who are in that space can really make money in future. So again, lots of other opportunities. I think we are already like 35, nearing 40 minutes into the session. So I will just go very, very briefly over some of those things. So user experience, guys. So your, for example, wearable devices, your mobile apps, lots and lots of mobile apps required. So people who are in, you know, from your application development background, if you want to, so we think there are millions of apps, but trust me, IoT apps are just starting to come. Millions upon millions of apps are required in future, which are not going to be about human interaction as such, but are going to be about machine-to-machine interface, where things talk to things and these apps decide everything. So apps are going to be a very important part of the overall you know, future landscape, and people who have skills in that area, big opportunities opening up. So this is about Axelta. You know, we have IoT trainings, we have 5-day sessions, 3-day sessions, we have analytics trainings, we are launching several new trainings. Because we have developed products in IoT space, we have a lot of understanding of IoT and how it's going to play out. And that's all what all we bring to you as a part of this training. So basically, now let me go to question answers. Let me see if any questions are there. Let me try and answer those. Okay. Okay, let me go through the questions which are not answered. I think many of the questions must be answered by now. But let me again go through some of them. If a person is not from technical background, don't know any technical background, how will he benefit from this course? Which will be correct course for non-technical? See, basically, this IoT bootcamp that we do is completely, you know, for people from all walks of life. Even if you are a highly technical architect, or you are a finance guy, or a project manager, or you know, from some domain, this can help you understand IoT end to end. Trust me on that. You will be able to understand IoT and make use of a lot of doctors. For example, I was shocked myself when a heart specialist recently attended a training and I asked him, like, well, how do you want to use it? And he says, I want to understand how it impacts me. And then he was also technically savvy, it seems, and he said, I want to work with some engineers and somebody to create maybe some device in my domain. So there are people like that attending our sessions today. So data analytics is one side, but I explained a lot of use cases, right? Your healthcare, retail, water management, railway management, traffic management, your forest management. Or I discuss in my training also, I give you example of at least 30-40 domains. Agriculture, huge area opening up. Okay, so Watson is IBM. Watson is basically, you know, about analytics basically. You know, where Watson is nothing but a cloud-based analytics piece, which can couple with IoT and process your data and take action and store data and a lot of things. Okay. Yes, it's not a platform. I'll say IBM Bluemix is an IoT platform. IBM Watson is about the intelligent part of it, the big data analytics part of it. Okay. So sensing data, which is correct, is a very good question, Pankaj. You will have to experiment. And you have to have the sense of things, right? So you're trying to measure, let's say, temperature in a water boiler. Okay. If the water temperature starts coming at 3000 degrees Celsius, you know it's bad. Right? So you have to, first of all, in your systems, you can build those kind of logics, which can take care of data which is outlining data, basically, and only take care of your core data. Also, if a sensor is about to turn bad, you can have certain mechanisms to figure out based on your programming that, okay, this sensor is about to go bad and I need to replace it. But nothing beats testing. We have ourselves, for our devices, done lots and lots of testing to be able to figure out. Also, sensors are available in market in plenty, but there are different grades of sensors. For example, there is industrial grade, there is a consumer grade, there is a military grade, there is a medical grade, right? So if you want to, you select the grade. If you want to go for military grade, for example, which is the very expensive grade, but then you will get sensors which are highly accurate and which will not go bad soon. So it depends on your use case, what kind of sensors you want to use. Yes. Do you have any basic free tutorial for Arduino with cloud connection? So we don't have any free tutorial as such, Rahul, but definitely you can join our training and we can help you understand that in quite some detail. What kind of programming would be involved for protocol programmers? I mean the use case. So there are lots of programmings involved, you know. For example, typically it's used C language, but nowadays even Python and other languages can be used for developing protocols. Even Java can be used in certain cases to develop protocols. And a plethora of protocols available. And if you know basic programming, you can develop protocols. Or you can develop wrappers around protocols to make use of them. So interoperability is a big issue, Pankesh, you know, in IoT. That's where you have, you know, a lot of these consortiums coming up. Like I said, Google Thread, there's MFI from Microsoft, there's IIC protocol, you know, there's so many protocols which we discuss in our training in some detail. And these protocols are trying to do that, what you're saying, interoperability, technology and how devices can talk to each other. A lot of manufacturing in companies have come together. For example, Samsung recently joined Google Thread Protocol, saying my products will be Google Thread compatible. So Samsung devices can talk to Google devices, vice versa. So those kind of things are happening in the industry. Beacon is basically somebody who understands how to use beacon, let's say in a retail. Okay, first is the technology of beacon, which is fairly simple. I will not say it's complex, but of course you have to, somebody has to do that. Second is about how to use beacon in retail, or how to use beacon in identity management and stuff like that. Big areas opening up in that. So Vijay, you know, good question. You need not be in hardware software, but you must be working somewhere, right, in some domain, you know, or something you must be doing. So whatever you are doing, you can be a business expert on IoT. IoT is like that, very domain specific. A lot of business knowledge people require to make a successful IoT device. It's not just about technology and databases and stuff like that. It's also about business, lots and lots of business common sense required to make an IoT device. And that's where you can play a part. And if you are in some domain, then you can definitely play a part in that domain. Yes, you know, I'll give you an example where, as I said earlier, we visited this plant where, trust me, more than 10,000 pumps and motors are used in just that one plant. Okay, and you can imagine there are thousands of such plants worldwide. And ABB, for example, is coming up with a device called a smart sensor, which is about putting that smart sensor on top of a motor. Okay, you have to attach it externally, and then it starts sending data to ABB cloud-based system. And ABB is able to figure out, based on the harmonics of that motor, whether the motor requires maintenance. You know, so that itself, you know, such a device is still, it's going to be launched in October, I think. That's what ABB declared. Maybe it will get delayed because it's a fairly complex thing to build on. But then if somebody can build such kind of devices for machines, for factories, for things that we use all around, which you can retrofit on existing things, huge, huge, real use case, Pankesh. SAP Finance, Oracle. So Madhusudan, I don't know any specific certifications. So we are launching an ACIP certification, okay, which is Excelta Certified IoT Professional. We are world's largest IoT trainer. We are also tying up with universities now to launch accredited course in IoT, like 2-credit course in engineering colleges in India. Already we are tying up with 2 universities to do that. So our certification carries a lot of value. So we are launching this ACIP certification as soon as 1st of August. You know, that's the plan. IoT has a lot of scope. Python has a lot of scope in IoT. You know, there are Python and R programming interfaces. Python is also being used for doing hardware side of programming and stuff. So a lot of scope in Python in IoT. So Pankaj, this is a webinar. Detail use case. We have lots of detail use cases in our training. In fact, you will build a use case in our training, which is about an end-to-end IoT device for logistics. And in the IoT analytics training, you're building that use case for insurance domain, a use case using analytics for insurance. So a lot of scope. So user experience designers, I mean people who can, you know, build those apps which can really help IoT. So for example, let's say there is a burglar who entered into your home. Now people need to be informed. So how they need to be informed? What kind of user interface will be there? You know, how the police will be informed about that. You want to unlock and lock your home through your mobile phone. What kind of user interface should be there? So it should be intuitive enough to do it. And if you are not interfering and intruders detected, it automatically does that work for you. So intuitive kind of user experiences, you know, where an ad, for example, if I talk about digital ads which are going to happen because of IoT and beacon technology, which will take your name. For example, you're watching TV and a TV ad takes your name. Okay, and it says that yesterday you were searching Suhani for a shirt, blue shirt, and today that blue shirt is available from Van Heusen for 10% discount specially for you. So that kind of interactive kind of ads and user experience design requires a lot of people who can think about how people think and how they behave, you know, much more than before, because now these devices are going to become intelligent and they are going to give you data. How we can make use of that data is really the key of understanding IoT. So Rasika, that's a very wide question on more info about developing wearable devices. really answer it here, but definitely we have already built a wearable device training course, but we have not yet launched it. So we are trying to launch it. So we are looking for trainers and stuff who can help us do that. So Raspberry Pi is not really an IoT. You know, you can use it for prototyping, but typically it's more expensive. It has a microprocessor, which is like, you know, 500 MB RAM or something like that. When we are talking about IoT, we are talking about 38 KB RAM. You know, thousandth times less RAM than what a Raspberry Pi has. Because that will cost you, that RAM will cost you 3 cents or 5 cents. And then you can attach some sensors to it and make it work for less than a dollar value. With Raspberry Pi, it's difficult to do that. So that's why Arduino is much better. But Raspberry Pi has its own uses. When you require some processor and you don't mind the cost, then you go for Raspberry Pi. Okay, there are some more questions. Let me check the time. Okay, I'll take 2-3 more questions and then I'll call it a day. So web developers have a huge opportunity, you know, when I talk about cloud-based systems, right, or systems where integration with backend things are required. The RESTful API-based system. RESTful API is emerging as a default, de facto integration piece. So a lot of people required on that side. MQTT broker, for example, MQTT web client, for example, all these are right. So on the side of things, all programming required. There are literally today hundreds of platforms, all of them are being developed by web developers, right? All those user interfaces which need to be developed on the internet and stuff like that, all require web developers, right? So Android developers, you know, maybe not web developers, but Android developers also. I'm saying Android developers might be different from web developers, but that also is a huge area opening up. So Mahesh, as you understood now that you need to work on your profile and you need to position yourself internally in your company, you need to, suppose your company is into some way IoT space, you need to position yourself within your company in that space by maybe making presentations to your senior ups using what you learned in the training, that what all, and you know the business in which you're in, being there for 9 years, you can figure out areas where IoT is applicable now and make presentations to your company saying this is how IoT can help us achieve and solve this business problem. And once you do that, I'm sure you will carry a very enhanced on the IoT side. Okay guys, so what I'll do is I'll call it a day now. So Google Thread, Rahul, let me take this last question. Google Thread is basically Google acquired a company called Nest, which had a protocol called Nest protocol. Google took that over and now it is called Google Thread ecosystem, where, you know, once you, they are saying that devices, for example, let's say in your home, you have an Android phone, you have a Samsung washing machine, a Samsung TV, you have LG refrigerator, Philips Hue bulbs, you have so many devices in your home. Okay, then if Google Thread is a ecosystem or as a protocol is accepted by all these other companies, you know, their products, then they can directly with Google Android phone and send it out to a cloud-based system. Essentially, it's about, you know, building a standard which makes it things interoperable. So I cannot explain everything here. Please join our trainings if you want, and you can get much more knowledge about IoT, deep dive knowledge about IoT. Okay, guys, so I think I'll take one last question. I've just started learning Java. Will I get any benefit in Arduino? Yes, learning anything will help you. So Pankesh, you know, why don't you get in touch with me? Okay, I will just share my email address. Okay, just get in touch with me and, you know, we can talk about it. Okay, guys, so thanks for joining our webinar. Thanks for taking your time. And I hope you had a good IoT journey in your life. That's the next area that is, you know, coming up, and huge opportunities opening up in this space. Also, you know, those who attended our webinar, we'll make you a part of our Google group, okay? And you can then participate in a lot of animated discussions on IoT and stuff. Okay, so we'll make all of you part of our Google Group. Okay, guys, then thanks very much for attending the webinar. Please do visit us at www.excelta.com. Bye-bye.